Morning, everybody. So first of all, my handwriting is terrible and my English is not so good either, so I don't know what you are going to learn. Also, as Felix said, I mean, you should ask questions, you know, anytime during the lecture. This is the only way I can learn from you, actually. You know, if you are asking good questions, I will be smarter at the end of the lecture than at the beginning, right? So we have four lectures, and I'm supposed to cover, let's say, the standard model, electric symmetry breaking, and X-physics. So the way I've organized the lectures are the following. By the way, I posted some lecture notes on internet. There are also some homework exercises, you know, and things that I won't have time to cover during the lecture. If you want to do a little bit more computation, you're welcome. And of course, you should ask me any question that you have during the breaks or anything, right? So the first lecture today will be mostly devoted about, let's say, an introduction to the standard model and electric theory. So how we end up with the standard model gauge group, which is, let's say, SU3 cross SU2 cross U1, right? So in this lecture, I won't talk so much about QCD, but hopefully you will learn about SU2 cross U1, right? So the second lecture, we are going to talk about the Goldstone equivalent theorem. And we will discuss WW scattering. We will understand why we need, actually, at the end of the DX, why we need the Higgs boson to make sense of the SU2 cross U1 theory, right? And then in the third lecture, so number one, number two, number three, I will be talking about renormalization group effect in X physics. So this will be a discussion, let's say, of stability of the electric vacuum, and also about the hierarchy problem, depending exactly the renormalization of which term of the X potential you are looking at, right? And in the fourth lecture, it will be oriented toward physics beyond the standard model. I'll be talking mostly about effective field theory and maybe some concrete model of physics beyond the standard model that could explain various things that remain mysterious about the physics of the Higgs boson, right? So, as Joachim said, I mean, Mainz is famous, you know, for his history. He started with Roman, so here we'll also start with Roman. We'd like to start with the Fermi theory, basically, the Fermi theory for the beta decay. So that was really, I think, the beginning, let's say, of what will become the standard model. So the beta decay, you know, is some decay of some nucleus. So if you try to remember a little bit of atomic physics, if you start with a nucleus A with a number of protons Z and a number of nucleon A, then you can observe this kind of nuclear reaction that you are losing. You are losing one proton, you are losing one neutron, and you are getting one proton. So it's A, Z plus 1, and the same number of nucleon, right? So of course it's not A, it's A prime here, right? You are changing, it's some kind of alchemy, where really you are playing with nucleus. I mean, different nucleus becomes other nucleus. And there are various famous examples of this type. So you can start with potassium that goes into calcium, for instance, right? Actually, it's A plus. Or you can start with copper that goes to zinc, or you can start with AV hydrogen that becomes helium, right? So it's helium plus. Right? So the question is really, what is going on into those reactions? So clearly here, I've already told you, you know, it's one neutron that becomes one proton, right? And of course, the other thing that you want also to conserve the electric charge, so you emit actually a positron in this reaction, right? It's plus E plus, E minus. So you get, yeah, sorry, it's not a positron, it's an electron, right? Okay. So I've already told you what is really happening at the elementary level is really a neutron that transforms into a proton plus an electron, right? So it's a decay of one particle into a two-body final state, right? And then you learn actually from the simple laws of special relativity in this case that you can actually compute explicitly the energy of the final state particle as a function of the masses of the different particles. It is just pure kinematics, so there is you don't need to know anything about the dynamics, so you don't need exactly what are the interactions that proceed through this reaction, but you can actually compute exactly the spectrum, right? So it's a simple exercise of special relativity. You will find that the energy of the electron, for instance, in this case, is simply the mass of the neutron square plus the mass of the proton square minus the mass of the electron square divided by twice the mass of the neutron, right? For most of what I'm going to say in those lectures, of course, we will work in natural unit where h bar is equal to c is equal to 1, right? So we'll drop the c factor in all my expression. So that was quite simple, but unfortunately doesn't exactly match with what is observed. So people, look at, for instance, what is the spectrum of the final state electron in this case, and instead of having, a fixed energy, they find actually something that varies depending on the observation. So you have the spectrum of the electron that looks like this. Well, maybe there is a little bump due to threshold effect, okay? So that's the number of electron, and that's the energy of the electron. So that seems in contradiction with special relativity, right? You don't have a fixed energy there. And incidentally, the final the endpoint of the spectrum is actually close to what is predicted by special relativity. But still, the energy can be much lower than this, right? So that was a real puzzle. At the beginning of the 20th century, people didn't understand at all what was going on into those reactions. And there were wild speculation. People even say, well, at the end of the day, it's quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, energy is not conserved. So that could be really the explanation of these things, right? So people were really ready to give up on some basic conservation law, like conservation of the energy. And probably you already know actually the answer to this conundrum. In 1930, Pauli actually proposed that it's not a two-body decay, but actually that there is an extra hidden invisible particle that occurs into this reaction, right? In such a way that the neutron goes into a proton plus an electron plus actually a neutrino, or an antineutrino in this case, right? So that was a new invisible particle, so it was not seen in your detector or whatever, simply because at the end of the day this particle is neutral, so it doesn't really interact with the rest of matter, right? So in this case, indeed, you have a free-body final state, right? And in this case, this relation doesn't hold anymore. The energy of the electron is not fixed only by the mass, but it can vary over a range of energy. And certainly in this case, so the energy of the electron has, of course, to be larger than the mass of the electron, and that's just an Einstein relation. And you can compute that it has to be smaller than the mass of the neutron squared plus the mass of the proton squared, mass of the electron minus mass of the proton plus the mass of the neutrino squared divided by twice the mass of the neutron. Right. So given the fact that the end of the spectrum here is very close, if not equal to what is predicted by the two-body final state decay, means actually that the mass of the neutrino has to be very small, if not equal to zero, right? So that was one first prediction of Pauli, that the mass of the neutron is close to zero. Actually, it's much, much smaller than the mass of the electron, right? So do you know actually how the neutrino are produced in nature? What is the dominant production mode of neutrino? Nobody knows. From the sun, yeah, okay, yes. But let's say in the labs, how do you produce the neutrinos in the lab? Well, one good source of neutrino is actually from the decay of the pion. So your pion is, you know, is just one composite object emerging from QCD, right? So it's a meson, and the pion decays actually in a muon plus a neutrino. So we'll come back to this reaction in a moment. That's quite it's quite interesting reaction that will teach us a lot about the structure of the electroweak interaction, actually. You know, because you could have expected that the pion will decay into an electron and a neutrino, right? Since the mass of the electron is smaller than the mass of the muon, just from kinematics, you will expect that this decay mode will be larger than this one, right? But it, in nature, it doesn't occur. Actually, there is a ratio of 10 to minus 4 for the decay width of electron over the muon, right? So this is basically much suppressed compared to the other. So one question, of course, that occurs is whether, you know, those neutrinos are the same. I mean, the neutrino that you get here from the pion decay are the same that the neutrino that you get from beta decay, from the decay of a neutron into a proton plus an electron. And the answer to this question actually comes from the observation that the muon actually doesn't decay into an electron, right? So you never, sorry, photon. So you never observe this this decay. And this is somehow telling you that the muon can indeed decay into an electron plus a neutrino plus an antineutrino. But the way you want to explain that you never observe this decay of a muon into an electron plus a photon means actually that, you know, there is a notion of an electron and muon number, and those have to be conserved in any reaction, right? So you introduce the leptonic number, so the number of electron and the number of muon, and they have to be conserved in any reaction. So this could be compatible with this decay of a muon, provided, of course, that you have at least two flavors of electron. One here is associated to the electron, and the other is actually associated to the muon, right? In such a way that in each of those reactions, those two numbers are actually conserved, right? Of course, you have to understand that the antineutrino are the opposite electronic number compared to the neutrino, right? So the first time, of course, the neutrino was observed was in 53 in an experiment by Cowan and Reines. So the first observation of the neutrino, and I think the observation of the second neutrino, let's say the muon neutrino, came in 62 in experiment by Lederman, Schwartz and Steinberger. They all got the Nobel Prize, of course, for that. And this observation actually comes from the inverse beta decay. So in this case, you are looking at actually at the proton that is transformed into a neutron, right? And what was observed? So again, you are producing actually, you know, the neutrino from this decay of the pion. So here it's antineutrino of the muon. And what you observe is that, you know, you can get a proton combining with an antineutrino that goes into a neutron plus a muon, plus an anti-muon, right? So this was observed, but those people never observe actually the converse reaction, which is neutron plus a positron, right? This was not observed, and that was really the clear evidence that there is indeed two flavors of neutrino, right? So there is a muon neutrino that can indeed produce a muon by inverse beta decay, but it can never produce a positron simply because it doesn't have the right flavor number. Right? So that was the experimental part, right? So now we have understood actually that we really have an interaction among four particles, right? A neutron that goes into a proton, an electron, and an antineutrino. So that was pure kinematics. Now we need to understand actually what is the dynamics behind this reaction. And the first person that, you know, wrote really a dynamical expression for this interaction was Fermi in the year of 1933. He's saying, well, it's an interaction among four particles, so the simplest thing that I can do is simply write a four Fermi interaction, right? So he wrote this kind of Lagrangian. So there is a constant in front of it that he called Fermi constant, right? It's cool when you're the first to do anything, you can really name everything the way you want, right? Actually, I'm not even sure that he called it the Fermi constant. That's maybe what comes out later, right? Anyway. So it's a simple four Fermi interaction, you know, which is built, let's say, in analogy with a current-current interaction for electromagnetism, right? So here, I've been maybe a little bit sloppy. You can also introduce, actually, at the end of the day, you can introduce some Dirac matrices, you know. So all these fermions are described by Dirac spinners, and you are allowed, in principle, to write any kind of Dirac matrices between those Dirac spinners, right? So maybe by analogy with electromagnetism, you would like actually to at least put a gamma mu, right? In such a way that this Lagrangian is really a current-current interaction, something that is, for instance, produced by the exchange of a photon, right? So for photon, you certainly know exactly the expression of this current, you know, for electromagnetism. This is just the sum of all the particles, let's say particle I. You have the electric charge, psi I, gamma mu, psi, right? So here, clearly the question is actually what is equivalent for the electric interaction, right? For the beta decay, right? So we still don't know exactly what is the form of the current associated to this beta decay. So experimentally, you know, you can from that you can compute the neutron lifetime, right? And you can indeed measure what is the expression, what is the value of this Fermi constant, right? And you will find something like 10 to minus 5 divided by the proton mass squared. So this is actually a dimension-full quantity, right? It's a dimension-full quantity simply because here you are dealing with spinners, and what is the canonical mass dimension of a spinner? Do you know that? 3½, yes, right? So this means that here, you know, the mass dimension of this is mass to the 6, right? So if you want the Lagrangian to be 4, you need a constant which has the inverse dimension of a mass squared, right? Good. So now we have learned about this dynamics, right? And we would like to go a little bit further and see what we can do with this dynamics. So the first question is actually, can we be sure, you know, that the same dynamics is really controlling the neutron decay and also the muon decay, like in this one, right? And that was an interesting question, you know, because if you look at the lifetime of those particles, they are actually quite different, right? So what is the lifetime of a muon? Do you know? Yes? 10 to minus 6 seconds, yes. Good. And what is the lifetime of a neutron? 15 minutes. Yes, in second is something like 900 seconds, right? So it's not obvious a priori that, you know, you have the same dynamics that really control those two decays, right? The lifetime is so different, there is 10 order of magnitude difference, right? So usually, you know, the same physics give rise to phenomena that are of the same order, right? But here you have 10 order of magnitude difference. So it's quite puzzling actually to even think that you could have the same dynamics controlling those two decays, right? But fortunately, we can understand that just using dimension analysis, right? So try to guess whether or not we are on the right track, whether we understand really the decay of those two particles, right? So as I say, here, you're dealing with an interaction which has a mass, right? A dimension. It's inverse of a dimension, inverse of the mass squared, right? So now if you compute the lifetime, you know, so it's certainly proportional to G Fermi squared, right? Because the matrix element will be proportional to one interaction, so the lifetime will be, or the decay width will be proportional to the squared of the interaction. So now, just by dimensional analysis, so the width as dimension of a mass. So this is mass to minus 4. So this clearly means that you need a fifth power of a mass, right, in order to get something which is dimensionally correct, right? So now the question is actually what is the right energy scale that you need to put on that, the right energy scale that control actually those decays, right? So what could be the mass scale associated to the decay of the muon? You have to guess, right?
The muon mass,
yes. So here you will use actually m equal to the muon mass, right? Which is of the order of?
100 MeV.
Good. So you know more than me. Good. And what will be the relevant mass scale for the neutron decay? Good. So the mass will be, okay, delta M, which is of the order of 1 MeV, yes. Right? So that's exactly what you expect, right? Here you have two order of magnitude, that's the fifth power, so you get your 10 order of magnitude difference for the lifetime or the decay width of the neutron versus the muon, right? So just by dimensional analysis, you understand actually that indeed it could be exactly the same dynamics that is controlling the neutron and the muon decay, right? Which are a priori totally different phenomena in different order of magnitude, right? Good. So now we can also understand by dimensional analysis that we have a problem with this Fermi theory when we are trying to go to high energy, right? Simply because, again, you're dealing with an interaction that has a dimension, right? And this... Yes?
How did we know that we should square GF in the first place? Is it because we have in mind that there's a matrix element?
Yes, absolutely, yes, yes. So from the Lagrangian, you compute the matrix element, which is proportional to the interaction, and then you square to get a rate or a decay rate or cross-section, right? Good. So, as I told you, now by dimensional analysis, you can also understand that you will have some problem when you're trying to extend, you know, this Fermi theory to high energy. Right? So far I was looking, you know, at decays of the particles, so the energy was fixed, no problem. But now I would like to look at a cross section, which could be mediated simply by a 2-2-2 cross section, a scattering, 2-2-2 scattering processes, which is mediated by this 4 Fermi interaction. So we have already understood that, you know, here you have some interaction, let's say, with the electron and the neutrino. So you can guess that actually in this weak current, you know, you will have something that will involve anyway the electron and the neutrino. So here we still don't know exactly what is a matrix element that you need to put, you know, the Dirac indices or whatever, but certainly the current will contain a piece like that. So that's a leptonic current, and you will have also a hadronic current that will involve, let's say, the neutron and the proton, right? So with another, well, maybe not the same, but okay, another matrix here, right? And we can, okay. So now we know that there is electron neutrino, and there will be also, let's say, a muon neutrino, right? Right. So that's what you can guess already from the structure of the current associated to the weak interaction. So now, if you squared, you know, I told you that this Lagrangian should be the squared of the current. So certainly, you will have a piece, you know. So here for the Fermi theory, you were keeping actually the cross term between the leptonic current and the hadronic current, but you will have also the squared of the leptonic current and the squared of the hadronic current, right? So you expect indeed to have an interaction which is two electron and two neutrinos, right? So this means that you can look at actually at the scattering of an electron over a neutrino, right? That is something which is again predicted by the Fermi theory, right? So the question is, what should you expect for the behavior of the scattering amplitude associated to this process, right? So what I'm interested in is actually what is the behavior of the cross section as a function of the energy in the center of mass of the electron on the neutrino. Right? So again, it should be proportional to G Fermi squared. Right? And what else? So what is the mass dimension of a cross-section?
Minus 2,
yes. And here G Fermi squared is m to minus 4, right? So I'm missing 2 power of the energy, right? So it should be proportional to E squared, right? And this is bad, right? This is bad because a cross-section cannot grow arbitrarily high with the energy. Otherwise, at some point, you will lose perturbative unitarity, right? The sum of the probability will be bigger than 1. So now you can start to put numbers, you know, so you certainly need to understand exactly when you are losing unitarity and things like that. So, but at the end of the day, you know, is basically when the cross-section is approaching pi or pi squared or whatever. So you know exactly the value of the Fermi constant. So you know that basically the Fermi theory is supposed to break down at energy below, let's say, of the order of 1 or 100 of GeV or so, right? Rough estimate with, I mean, there is maybe some factor of order 1 in front of this expression, right? Factor of pi, factor of square root of 2, etc. So you can spend the rest of your life actually computing these things, but anyway, the estimate of the order of magnitude at which, you know, you're losing control of your theory is this one, right? So now the question is actually what will replace the Fermi theory at energy above this 100 GeV and above this scale, right? So you already know, of course, the answer. The answer is simply the exchange of a gauge boson, right? I mean, it's again, you know, constructed in analogy with a photon. So in electromagnetism, the current-current interaction is simply due to the exchange of the photon. So at the end of the day, for QED, you know, you're writing things like that divided by Q squared, because it's just a momentum transfer, the momentum of the photon. And now, what you want to do is simply here introducing a massive gauge boson, so maybe minus the mass of the W squared, right? And then it will be proportional to the gauge coupling squared, right? Okay? So what you see as a contact interaction, let's say among the neutron, the proton, the electron, and the neutrino, is actually the exchange of a W gauge boson. So now I will probably screw up conservation of charge. Okay, P, W, electron, and neutrino. Okay. So what appears to be a contact interaction is simply due to the exchange of a massive gauge boson, you know. And here you have one propagator, so it's 1 over Q squared minus the mass of the W. So if you are at small energy, you know, you can neglect actually Q squared over the mass, and you get something which looks like exactly the Fermi contact interaction, you know, something that is independent of the energy of the incoming particle. But when you go to high energy, so this Fermi constant, so this cross-section, let's say, that was growing like G squared E squared, is actually replaced by something like G to the fourth, right? So we have 2 gauge coupling here and here. So for the matrix element, it will be proportional to G squared. So the cross-section has to be proportional to G to the fourth. You will still get something that grows like E squared, but you have to divide by the propagator. So E squared plus MW squared, right? So again, you know, at low energy, you indeed end up with an expression exactly like the one predicted by the Fermi theory. But at high energy, so when the energy is above the mass of the W, then the dominant piece is not the mass anymore, but is actually the energy in the denominator in such a way that this goes to a constant and there is no problem with unitarity anymore, right? That goes to a constant at arbitrarily high energy, right? So of course, in principle, it's still not enough to be consistent with unitarity. You still need to make sure that this constant is small enough, is smaller than pi, etc. But that is just a condition, let's say, on the ratio of the gauge coupling divided by the mass of the W. Okay. So here, actually, you get exactly the matching between those two series. So you are able to compute the Fermi constant as a ratio of the gauge coupling divided by the mass of the W. Right? So again, there are some numerical factor, you know, square root of 2, etc. That's just some historical normalization. It doesn't really matter. That's a matching. So from here, you can already guess also what could be the mass scale of the W, right? So at that time, you know, people, of course, you don't know exactly what is the value of the gauge coupling. But again, you know, people were thinking really in analogy with QED. So they were saying, well, you know, this is of the order of 10 to minus 5 divided by the mass of the proton squared, right? If G is of the order of the electric charge, so if G is similar to the QED coupling, which is equal to, what is the value of the electric charge? 0.3, yes. So in unit where H bar is equal to C is equal to 1, the electric charge is 0.3, right? So if you put this, you will get actually a first estimate of the mass of the W, which happens to be close to the, no, to the, N, the cutoff of the Fermi theory that we have evaluated before. Right? So we have understood that you need a massive gauge boson. So now the question is actually what is, you know, the gauge theory associated to the exchange of a W, right? So you know that for QED you have U1 electromagnetism, right? So U1, so QED is based on an abelian gauge theory which is invariant under U1, right? So now you would like to compute, I mean, to guess what will be the gauge group associated to the exchange of a W, right? So we still don't know, and that's what we want to figure it out. What is really the gauge interaction associated to the weak interaction? So we don't know exactly yet, but we can guess, we can make some guess and try to do a little bit of thinking, right? So the first thing that you notice is that the W is an electric charge object, right? Because simply the four Fermi interaction is actually a charge current interaction. So here, simply by conservation of the electric charge, you know, you start with an electron which has electric charge minus 1. So let's say if the W goes into this direction, it has to carry an electric charge minus 1. Right? The neutrino is electrically neutral, right? And the same thing is also true. The proton is neutral. The proton is plus 1. So everything is consistent with electric charge conservation. So the W carries an electric charge, right? So this means that it will actually interact with a photon, right? The photon interacts with everything that carries an electric charge. That's the basic law of QED, right? So you know already that you have a W interacting with a photon, right? So W plus, W minus, the photon, right? So this means that you will have some interaction among the gauge boson, something that never occurs in QED. You know, QED, the photon is electrically neutral object, so it doesn't interact with itself, at least at the classical level. So you can have some light-by-light scattering. This is a loop process, but at the classical level, the photon doesn't interact with itself. While here, I mean, everything that I'm doing at the moment is classical, right? So at the classical level, we have learned that the W need to interact with the photon. And this requires some non-abelian structure for the gauge symmetries. Okay, so what are the possible non-abelian groups that can actually describe those interactions? Yes?
So the whole thing will go to the mediator is a jar scale.
Good question. Yes. You could have an interaction which is a scalar interaction, so yeah. Well, yeah, at the end of the day here, probably you need to understand that you need actually a space-time index on this current. So this So what will be the problem with the scalar? I don't know, actually. But again, I mean, it was done by analogy with QED, so you know that you have an index mu for QED, just for the photon, you know, A mu.
So you do it without getting this
phenomenon? Yes. Yes. I don't know what will go wrong if you're doing that. At some point, you will encounter some problem, of course. But at the moment, I don't remember which problem you will find, you will face. Yeah. That's your homework for tomorrow, right? I mean, okay, maybe, yeah, I don't know. So the fact, where did I wrote it? No. The fact that the pion here, yeah, I say that the pion decay into a muon and not an electron, you know, is a good indication of the structure of the Lorentz structure of this current. And so I don't want to tell you the answers to exactly why, you know, you have the decay into a muon and not an electron, because that's one exercise that you have to solve. But that's really a clear indication of the Lorentz structure. But I'm not sure that this requires gamma mu. It requires another structure for sure, in addition to gamma mu. But I have to think about the gamma mu, okay? Anyway, so so here we are looking for a non-Abelian interaction that can really describe, let's say, QED and the beta decay, right? So you have at least three gauge bosons, you know, the photon, W plus and W minus. And what else do you know? You know that certainly the electron and the neutrino comes into an irreducible representation of the gauge group because they are interacting with a W, right? So these are the two facts that you want to think about in order to build your theory, right? So you want a gauge group that contains at least three gauge bosons. Know the W plus, W minus, and the photon, so at least three gauge boson. And you also want to make sure that the neutrino and the electron goes into an irreducible representation of the gauge group, right? So what are the possible gauge group that fill the bill? Well, the simplest thing that you could think of is simply SU2. Right, that's a group of dimension 3, so you will have three gauge boson. So which are the other group of dimension 3 that you can think of? I will write them here just for completeness, but we will discard them very quickly. Right. So the other possibility is SU1,1, and there is a Euclidean group in two dimensions. I think that's the only gauge group, non-Abelian gauge group of dimension 3, right? So, so here, okay, so three gauge boson, you will associate a generator to each of those gauge boson, right? And since you want this interaction between the photon and the W, you know what, you need actually an algebra for the non-Abelian group that satisfied t plus minus, so time q, yes. So the commutator of the electric charge associated to the photon and the generator associated to the W plus and W minus should satisfy at least this kind of commutation relation, right? So that's the way you want to describe really the photon interaction with the W, right? So again, here I'm simply looking at the possible algebra that will involve this commutation relation, right? So the only thing that I'm missing now is actually what is a commutation relation between, let's say, t plus and t minus, right? That's the only thing that I need to specify to fully characterize my algebra, my gauge group, right? So SU2 will be characterized by t plus t minus is actually equal to the electric charge. SU1,1 is simply actually flipping a sign, you know, in the signature of the group. So it will be t plus t minus equal to minus q. And for E2, the Abelian Euclidean group is simply t plus t minus, which is equal to zero, right? So that's all the possibility that you have at your disposal. So what are the problem with SU1, 1 and E2? Well, SU1, 1, I mean, just that the meaning of this signature, of this comma here, it's actually a non-compact group, right? So it's not non-compact. And if you open any representation book on or book on representation of gauge group, you will understand actually that there is only one unitary representation, only one, and this one has a dimension which is infinite. Right. So this means that you cannot actually describe this kind of interaction, I mean this kind of particle contained. You will need, you will predict actually an infinite number of particles that hasn't been observed in nature yet. Right. So this cannot describe the weak interaction. Okay. What about E2? Actually, in this case, you have also only one unitary representation of finite dimension, and this representation is a trivial representation that contains only one element that is the unity, right? So only one unitary representation of finite dimension. And this is a trivial representation. So again, it doesn't, it cannot be used to describe the interaction of a neutrino with the electron, right? So you eliminate this possibility as, right? So we end up with the only possibility now, which is SU2, right? And this is actually what is called the Georgi-Glashow model in 72. So Georgi and Glashow try to really describe the weak interaction in terms of SU2 in 72, right? So 45 years ago. So that's one possibility, but there is one further prediction in this model, You know that the trace of the generator, I mean, since you are dealing with SU, the trace of the generator has to vanish over all irreducible representation, right? So the trace, in this case, let's say the trace of T3, which is, let's say, the generator associated to the electric charge, the trace of T3 in the irreducible representation has to vanish, right? Because you are dealing with special unitary group, right? But the problem is that the trace of the electric charge on an electron on a neutrino is non-zero, right? The electric charge of an electron is -1. The electric charge of the neutrino is zero, so the trace is not vanishing. So this means that this is only part of the irreducible representation. You need to add extra particle to have the trace to vanish, right? So this means that the Georgi-Glashow model actually is predicting extra matter, right? Right. So you need really, let's say, the neutrino, the electron, and here you're predicting a new particle X, which will have a charge, an electric charge +1, right? +1, 0, -1, in such a way that the trace is zero, and this will form an irreducible representation. So anticipating on what you probably know, actually, this is only the left-handed chirality of the electron and the neutrino, and you need actually to have a different irreducible representation for the right-handed electron. And again, the right-handed electron has a charge +1. Oh, okay. +1 here. So in order for the electric charge, the trace of the electric charge to be zero, you're also predicting, let's say, a right-handed neutrino and another particle X of charge +1, -1. So that will be the left-handed chirality, that will be the right-handed chirality. So here you are really predicting, you know, a few new particles for the theory to be consistent mathematically, right? So that's really the prediction of your analysis, right? If you don't want to add extra forces, so if you want really to stick to the gauge group that has only three gauge bosons, so gauge group of dimension three, you are led to the prediction that you need to introduce extra matter. Right? There is no way around. I mean, that's just mathematics, right? To have the theory to be fully consistent. Right? But there is an alternative to that, is to assume that actually there is more than three gauge boson. Right? So you don't, you are trying actually to introduce extra forces in order to avoid to introduce extra matter. Right? That's the two choices. Either you have more matter or you have more forces. Right. So again, you are thinking in terms of minimality. So the minimal thing that you can introduce is one more gauge boson. Right. So you would like to try SU2 cross U1. Right. That will be dimension 4. So you are simply introducing one gauge boson. Right. So now the thing that you need to specify is actually how you embed, let's say, the electric charge into this gauge group, right? So you could think of having the electric charge to be equal to, let's say, T3 of SU2. But this is exactly equivalent to the Georgi-Glashow model. You know, the trace of T3 has to be zero, so you are led to the conclusion that you need to introduce extra matter again, right? So this is probably doesn't work, right? Or at least, again, you are led to the conclusion that you need to introduce both extra forces and extra matter. So something that you would like to avoid just by minimality. So you could think that the electric charge will be identified with a U1 gauge factor that I will call hypercharge for some reason that will become clear in a moment. Right? This doesn't work either because, okay, these two group commute, right? So this means that the electric charge of all the irreducible representation of SU2 will be equal. So this will predict that the electric charge of the neutrino is equal to the electric charge of the electron, right? Something that is obviously wrong, right? So this doesn't work. So then the next trivial thing that you can try, you know, is simply that the electric charge is actually a combination of, let's say, the diagonal generator of SU2 and the U1 generator, so T3 plus the hypercharge, right? And you all know that this is actually the answer. You know, you can really embed all the particle content into this representation with a definition of the electric charge, which is related to T3 and the hypercharge, right? So this is called the Gell-Mann-Nishijima formula, right? So what is the right name? Nishijima. Is there a Japanese here that can pronounce it? No. Actually, it's two different papers. So Gell-Mann found it in 1956, and a few years before it was actually Nishijima. And Nakano. In 1953, right? So I don't know what happened to this guy, but okay, his name has been dropped from this famous formula. So I don't know. If you are interested in history, you can look at it and tell me exactly what happened with these two people, right? Okay. So now it was really an experimental question. You know, we have two minimal models that are mathematically consistent. One is predicted extra forces, right? So here you have extra forces. Right, but a priori no extra matter. I mean, okay, I haven't derived it here, but you can really, assign some electric charge here. You know, I mean, you have simply a doublet here, and you can find the right hypercharge to be compatible with the electric charge. So at the end of the day, in this case, it will be y is equal to minus 1/2, right? In such a way that the electric charge of the neutrino, T3 is the upper component, so it's plus 1/2, minus 1/2, so this is equal to zero. And the electric charge of the electron is T3 is equal to minus 1/2, minus 1/2 for the hypercharge, so this is equal to minus 1, right? So that works, and okay, you can also embed, the right-handed electron. So this is a left-handed electron, and the right-handed electron will be simply a singlet under SU2, and it will have an hypercharge which is equal to minus 1, so it's 0 minus 1, which is equal to minus 1, right? So this is perfectly compatible with the electromagnetic properties of the neutrino and the electron, right? So the conclusion is that here you need extra forces, but you don't need extra matter, right? You can really describe all what you know from the particle and their interaction in this model, and this is consistent. So you have really two choices. No, here you have prediction of extra matter, but no extra forces, or here you have extra forces, but no extra matter. Right, so now it's really an experimental question, which way nature have chosen, right? So of course, those particles have been searched for, new lepton with some electric charge. There have been plenty of experiments looking at that, and looking at them, and all this experiment didn't get any result, right? So now we would like to see how you can actually see a new force, right? So you can understand very easily that actually this new force will correspond to a neutral current, so exactly something similar to the exchange of the photon. So I told you the exchange of a W is a charge current. I mean, we have already seen here, right, that the W carries an electric charge, so the current associated to the exchange is a charge current. In this case, this extra force actually corresponds to the to a new neutral current. So we would like to identify a new neutral current, but that's not so easy to do, right? Because usually if you have an extra neutral current, I mean, you need to find a way to distinguish with the exchange of the photon, right? So basically you are looking at some processes that will involve this new neutral current, but the processes that cannot be mediated by the exchange of the photon in order to really make the difference between, let's say, this new force and the photon, right? So the idea will be, again, to use the neutrino, right? The neutrino is an electrically neutral object, so it doesn't interact with the photon, right? So you want certainly to have an interaction that involves the neutrino, and you want a process that cannot be mediated again by the charge current, right? In order to be able to distinguish uniquely this new interaction. And this the process that people have had in mind is, again, looking at the scattering of an electron on a neutrino in U. But this time, instead of compared to the previous reaction that I was mentioning, here I want to look at the scattering on a muon neutrino instead of an electron neutrino, right? In this case, I cannot have the charge current, I told you that if you're dealing with an electronic neutrino, then you have the exchange of a W, right? But now, if you're dealing with two different flavors, here, the vertex has to respect the flavor, so this cannot be mediated by the exchange of a W anymore, right? And as I told you, you cannot have an interaction with a photon, simply because the muon, the neutrino, are electrically neutral, right? So this electron neutrino, this is forbidden by QED, right? Because this is the neutrino has an electric charge which is equal to zero. So the only possibility is indeed to have a new neutral gauge boson that we will call Z that will interact with the electron and the neutrino. Okay. So So if you're able really to see this process with a rate which is great enough, you have identified really this new neutral current, right? And this was exactly what was done at CERN in 1973. This is the Gargamel experiment that have really discovered this new neutral current. So they didn't get the Nobel Prize yet because it's a big collaboration, right? But they got this EPS prize, right? So one of the largest European prize for particle physics, right? So I told you that this process cannot be mediated by the charge current. Actually, I was lying a little bit. It cannot be mediated with a charge current at tree level. But there is actually a loop contribution that involves the exchange of a W, right? You can draw these diagrams, this one loop diagram, that probably the first one loop diagram that I will draw in this lecture. So you have the electron. So here you have the W. So you can exchange a neutrino electron up nu W nu mu with the muon nu mu, right? So at the loop level, you have indeed a contribution which is coming from the charge current or the exchange of a W. But of course, this is a loop diagram, so this is a quantum correction. And this is expected to be highly suppressed compared to the tree-level contribution. Right? So if you are able to see this process with a cross-section which is large enough, compatible with a tree-level exchange of a new particle, then you are sure that this is really the diagram that is mediated this interaction and not the loop contribution. Right? So it's a question of seeing this process with a large enough rate. Right? And that's exactly what the Gargamel experiment did. Right? That was really establishing the existence of this new neutral gauge boson, the Z gauge boson. So we have answers. I mean, we have understood the way nature have decided to go. So it really went not to the Georgia Glashow model, but with this SU2 cross U1 model, which is, of course, nowadays called the standard model. And there are names associated to it, and it's quite interesting also to look at the dates, which I've written here somewhere, forgotten where. Yes. So this is the model that was first proposed by Glashow in 1961. And then, of course, he went to this other model, 1972, Georgia Glashow. And then there is also Weinberg in 1967, and then it was Salam in 1968, right? And they all got the Nobel Prize for understanding that nature have decided to go through SU2 cross U1, right? Again, I'm not an expert in history, so I wouldn't tell you exactly what the difference between those three papers, but I mean, the Nobel Committee has decided that they were important enough and complementary enough to actually get give the Nobel Prize to those three people. And if you think about it, I think Glashow was really the first to understand that you have a symmetry that exchanges the neutrino with the electron, right? So you are saying somewhere in your theory that the theory remains invariant when you exchange a neutrino with an electron, and that's quite a bold assumption, right? A bold hypothesis, right? Because in everyday life, that the electron is very different from the neutrino. But still, he had this intuition that, the theory will remain invariant if you transform one into another. So that was really a challenging hypothesis that turns out to be right to some extent, right? Of course, this symmetry has somewhat to be broken because we know that there is different electric charge, and we also know actually that the masses of those two particles are totally different, right? So if the symmetry were exact, those two particles should have the same masses. But in practice, they have very different masses, so the symmetry has to be broken, and that's part of the Higgs story, right? So the way you want to understand the breaking of the symmetry is via the notion of spontaneous breaking. So you will say that the theory or the Lagrangian remains invariant under this SU2 symmetry, but the vacuum breaks this symmetry. Right? And that's the way you're able actually to generate the mass to the gauge boson, and also the mass splitting between the electron and the neutrino. Right? So that's the part that we are going to discuss now, actually the X mechanism and how you are breaking the symmetry by the vacuum. Right? Is there any question at this level? No? Minus one, yeah.
Where did that come from?
Well, simply because you know the electric charge of the electron. So if you want to be compatible with this expression,
so
you
that's
need.
What we're deducing.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, the non-trivial check here somehow is that you need to end up with the same hypercharge for the neutrino and the left-handed electron, right? That will be the thing that will make the structure of the group consistent with the electric charge of the different particle. So the only trivial check here that I was doing is that I'm using the same U1 charge for those two particles in such a way that you can put them into a doublet of SU2. Right? So putting them into a doublet of SU2, means that since those two components of the gauge group commute, means that they need to have a unique charge on the U1, right? So that's what works, right?
In terms of the historical story that was sort of presented here, why did we know that those SU2 triplets should be, the left and right handed components should be treated differently in the first place?
Right, that's really coming from the ratio of the decay width of the pion, right? So the pion decaying into muon and neutrino over the decay width of the pion decaying into electron and neutrino, as I tell you, is 10 to minus 4, right? Which is non-trivial if you think about phase space again. Phase space is larger here, right? So you would have expected this rate to be larger than this, but that doesn't happen. And this is somehow because, there is some notion of chirality flip. So this means that the theory has to be chiral, it's not a vector-like theory. Right. So somehow that's the conclusion that the W will couple only to the left-handed electron and not to the right-handed electron. So they needed to be treated separately with respect to the SU2 interaction. Right. So it's really purely driven by the observation of few experimental facts, right? Once you have really understood what is pure accident and what is really coming, let's say, from the structural reason, 10 to minus 4 is some large number that you, or small number that you need to explain, and you can explain that by simply some symmetry. So in this case, is chiral symmetry. Yeah, so maybe here, it's maybe a good point to really emphasize, the big difference between the standard model and QED. So QED is a vector-like theory, while the standard model is a chiral theory. So the left-handed chirality of the fermion transform differently compared to the left. Left and right have different transformation properties under the gauge symmetry. This is not the case of QED, and this is not the case of QCD either. Right? QCD and QED are vector-like theory. And actually, at the quantum level, there is some non-trivial consistency condition to have a chiral theory, which is called the anomaly cancellation. So here, I've described everything at the classical level. I've been able to assign some charges of quantum numbers for all the particles. I'm going to describe very quickly the charge of the quark also. That makes sense. You can assign some charges for the quark. But the theory is chiral, right? And for a chiral theory, you cannot give charges, arbitrary charges to all the particles. Otherwise, when you're doing quantum correction, you are generating some anomalies. So anomalies mean that, the symmetry, which is the symmetry of the classical level, will be broken by quantum effect. So you're computing some quantum correction, and this will give you a correction to the conservation of the current, right? So maybe I can say a few words here. This is an important thing. Yes?
Can this Georgia Glossner model
yes.
be consistent with the pion decay?
With pion decay. I think so, right? Because this is, again, I've introduced chirality, right? I've embedded the right-handed electron into a different representation of the left-handed electron. So this will, for instance, be able to generate this ratio of the decay. Yeah. Right-handed neutrino, yes. Yeah, but I don't think it will play any role here. I mean, it's quite plausible that actually in nature there is right-handed neutrino. Right? They are not really part of the standard model, but okay, that's one explanation, let's say, of the neutrino masses. You introduce right-handed neutrinos, right? And this is perfectly compatible with pion decay, right? There is no bound on the right-handed of the right-handed neutrino coming from pion decay. So there is no problem at this level, I think. But maybe I'm wrong, I don't know. You have to think more. So yeah, I was telling you that QED and also QCD actually is vector-like, while the standard model, so the electroweak gauge group, is a chiral theory, right? So the left-handed chirality have transformation property that are different from the right-handed chirality, right? And I told you that this can, in principle, generate some inconsistency at the quantum level. So you have a gauge symmetry, so you have a conserved current, so d mu g mu is equal to zero at the classical level, right? And that there's just an utter theorem, right? Every time you have a symmetry, you have a conserved current, a conserved charge, right? So that's true at the classical level. So now you can compute what is happening at the quantum level, and you will find that d mu g mu, so for A, will be proportional to the trace of TA, TB, maybe anti-commutator, sorry, TC times F mu nu B, F mu nu tilde C, right? With, one loop factor. So this will be particularly bad, you know, because this means that the current is not conserved. So this means that the symmetry is not a symmetry at the quantum level. And if it's not a symmetry, you know, you cannot quantize the theory, basically. You really need to enforce that the theory that describes those gauge bosons is invariant under the symmetry in order to be able to quantize the theory, right? I mean, if you go through the second quantization, etc., you will see that, you know, you have this whatever BRST formalism that, you know, decouples the bad degrees of freedom if the symmetry is an exact symmetry of nature. Okay, we can discuss, you know, about the meaning of symmetries, gauge symmetries, etc. They are not real symmetry, but at the end of the day, what matters is really that you are decoupling some degrees of freedom that leads to bad behavior of the theory. Either, you know, you have tachyons or thing or ghosts or things like that. So for that, you need to be able to decouple those degrees of freedom, and this will not be possible if this current is not conserved. Right? So you really need to make sure that this quantity, this anomaly factor, is actually vanishing. Right? And okay, now if you put all the indices, what you will see is that is a trace of on the left-handed chirality fermions of this anti-commutator here, minus the trace of the right-handed chirality. So if the theory is vector-like, you know, if the left-handed chirality have the same transformation properties as the right-handed chirality, this is automatically vanishing for vector-like, right? But this is not the case for a chiral theory. If left and right don't transform in the same way, you have potentially some anomalies. So you need to make sure that you assign really all the charge in such a way that this difference of the trace are vanishing. And this is not a totally trivial consistency check for the standard model particle content that indeed those traces are vanishing. So at the end of the day, you have two traces to compute. Is a trace of the hypercharge, which has to vanish, and the trace of the hypercharge cube, which has also to vanish. That's the only non-trivial trace. I mean, okay, if you put SU2, this is, you know, if you put, let's say, free SU2, you know, it will be automatically vanishing. If you put one, it will be automatically vanishing. So at the end of the day, it's really those two traces that are non-trivial to check. Right? And you know, it's really a non-trivial equation, you know, because this, okay, this is a linear equation according to the different charge of the particle, but this is a non-linear equation, you know, that involves the cube of the hypercharge. And why actually you're able to find, you know, a solution to those equations, I mean, is really non-trivial in a sense. There is a deep principle that tells you why at the end of the day, you know, this cubic equation can be satisfied, is coming from the fact that actually you're breaking SU2 cross U1, which is a chiral theory, into a vector-like theory, which is U1 of electromagnetism. Right? So something that we are going to see in a moment. So SU2 cross U1, which is chiral, is broken into U1 of electromagnetism by the vacuum, I mean the X-Vev, and this is vector-like, right? And the fact that it's a vector-like theory, actually, you can use this property to replace this cubic equation into a linear equation, and then you can easily find some solution to this equation. So actually, this is called the gravitational anomaly. So this is when you are replacing, let's say, two of the current by some exchange of the graviton. Right. But this is a trace of y is equal to zero. Okay. Yes. But those will be satisfied almost trivially, right? So the only non-trivial consistency check are those two traces that you have to satisfy. Okay. So maybe it's a good time actually to write the particle content, the full particle constant of the standard model. So far I've discussed mostly the lepton, but you certainly know that the proton and the neutron are not elementary particles, they are made of quark. And the question was, of course, how to embed the quark into representation of SU2 cross U1. So what are the particle constants? So you have the left-handed doublet of the lepton, which contains the neutrino and the electron. The left-handed chirality, you have the E right, which is simply the right-handed electron. So there is no right-handed neutrino in the standard model. Then you have the left-handed quark, which is up and down, left-handed component. There is upright, U right, which is a singlet, down right, which is a singlet under SU2, and that's it, right? And later on, we will add the X field into the picture. Right? So here, we'll write the quantum number under SU3, QCD, right? SU2, what I will call SU2 left, and U1 hypercharge, right? And at the end of the day, all these charges are just fixed in order to reproduce the electric charge of the different particle, right? So we already know that the electric charge of the neutrino is zero. The electron is -1, so -1 here. For the quark, right, you know that the proton is made of two up and one down, and you want an electric charge +1, so this means that the up has an electric charge +2/3, and the down is an electric charge -1/3, right? So here is +2/3, and down is -1/3, right? So that's basically the only thing that you need to remember, you know, if one day you are going on vacation on an island, in the Pacific, and you want to remember the quantum charges under the standard model, that's the only thing that you really have to remember, and you can fill out this table very quickly, right? So the lepton, by definition, are singlet under SU3, right? And the quark are triplet, which transform as a fundamental representation of SU3. For SU2, so here I told you that you have a doublet, singlet, and then, as I said, the only non-trivial check is really that you can assign a unique hypercharge to those doublets in order to reproduce this electric charge of the different particles. So here we have said that it's -1/2 for the left-handed doublet of the lepton. Here it's -1, okay. Q, I want 2/3. Should be equal to +1/2 plus the hypercharge, and minus one 1/3 should be equal to minus 1/2. So down, so it's t3 is equal to minus 1/2 plus y. And this is telling you that y is equal to 1/6, no? 1/2 plus 1/6 is 4, 3, yes, so that works. And these things, okay, they are singlet under SU2, so the hypercharge is equal to the electric charge, right? So it's 2/3 and minus 1/3, right? Okay? So with this particle content, you can check trivially those conditions, right? And they are satisfied, right? So there is no anomaly in the standard model. Okay, so this is a theory which is consistent at the quantum level. So there is one exercise that you can do. Actually, I told you that this anomaly anomaly condition, you know, at the end of the day is associated to the fact that U1 of electromagnetism is vector-like, right? And this actually fixes uniquely all these charges, right? So if you didn't know exactly about the quantum, the electric charge of the different particle, you can actually find those different factor here, minus 1/2, 1/6, 2/3, simply by trying to solve those equations. You know, there will be unique solution for those equations. So this is actually fixing, you know, the ratio, let's say, of the charge or the hypercharge of the electron versus the hypercharge of the quark, of the up quark, right? So here, basically, is anomaly condition, which is telling you that the electric charge of hydrogen atom is equal to zero, right? Because this is, at the end of the day, this is the electric charge of the electron, minus one, plus the electric charge of the proton. The proton is 2 up quark and 1 down quark, right? So 2 times 2/3 minus, minus 1/3, right? And this is equal to zero, right? But here, you know, it's really non-trivial, right? Because you need a precise relation between the electric charge of the electron and the electric charge of the quark, right? And somehow, you know, you are dealing with an abelian gauge group, so it's a U1 gauge group, so the charges are not quantized, right? So for SU2, you know, you have doublet, you have triplet, etc., but you know, it's only finite number of possibilities. If you are dealing with an abelian gauge group, you know, the group is not, I mean, the charges are not quantized, and you could have, in principle, any possible electric charge, right? So this is really a non-trivial fact that, you know, this electric charge have arranged themselves in such a way that the hydrogen atom is electrically neutral. And this is a classical level, but this is also true at the quantum level, so this ratio of charges don't receive any quantum correction. Right? And this is associated to the fact that at the end of the day, you don't have anomalies in the standard model, right? So the anomaly condition is, in a sense, compatible or equivalent to the neutrality of the hydrogen atom, right? So I told you that this anomaly cancellation condition fix the ratio of the electric charge of the electron divided by the electric charge of the, let's say, up quark, right? This is true, really, strictly speaking, in the standard model, so with this particular content. Of course, you could ask yourself what will happen, for instance, if I'm adding a right-handed neutrino. I've added one more particle. This particle can have actually an hypercharge quantum numbers, so it will enter into this anomaly condition, and you can repeat this exercise, and you will find that if indeed you have a right-handed electron, right-handed neutrino, then this ratio of the electric charge of the electron versus the electric charge of the up quark is not necessarily the one which is predicted by the standard model. But still, even if this ratio is free, you can check for yourself that still this anomaly condition will impose that the hydrogen atom is electrically neutral. Right. So this ratio of charges is not fixed by anomaly condition, but this is fixed by anomaly condition. Okay, one more comment about this anomaly cancellation. So here I told you that this is a result at one loop. So when you are doing one loop quantum correction to the standard model, You can ask yourself, you know, what will happen when I'm trying to do more and more loops. And actually, there is an important result in about anomaly, is that the anomaly can occur only at the one loop level. If the anomaly are canceled at one loop, you will never generate it at higher loop level. Right? So that's an important result. I wouldn't know how to prove it, but people have proven it. I mean, people doing quantum field theory have proven this result. So this is the only consistency condition that you have to worry, at least at the perturbative level. Right? Okay. So now I have a few more minutes maybe to start discussing the X mechanism and to discuss also an important additional symmetry that exists in the standard model, which is custodial symmetry. Right? So far I've discussed mostly the gauge symmetry, but there is actually an additional global symmetry of the standard model that explains some particular relation that exists in the standard model. And that will also explain at the end of the day what is the behavior, let's say, of the scattering amplitude in the standard model at high energy. So you really need to understand this extra global symmetry associated to the standard model. So so we have understood that you have SU2 cross U1 to describe the gauge interaction, and at the same time you also know probably that, I mean, that's something that we have already seen, that the mass of the W is non-vanishing, is something like 80 GeV. The mass of the Z is about 90 GeV. While the mass of the photon, as far as we know, is equal to zero, right? There is an upper bound on the mass of the photon, which I forgot is something like 10 to minus 18, maybe electron volt or something like that. So we are not sure yet that this is equal to zero, but this is something like 10 to minus 18 electron volt, I think. I mean, it's very nice experimental result. You really try to put an upper bound on the mass of the photon, right? I mean, it's interesting experimental physics, but okay. Theoretically, this is zero, right? So how can we understand this? You know, how do you generate the mass for the gauge boson? While if you're dealing with gauge symmetry, you know, the gauge boson transform non-linearly and under gauge transformation. Mu, okay. If you have phi that transform like U times phi, and U is a non-abelian transformation, you know that if in order to have the covariant derivative, which is invariant under the gauge transformation, or at least invariant up to a linear transformation, so d mu phi plus I j a mu phi, you know that a mu has to transform non-linearly, right? So a mu transform like, now I've probably written, shit. I don't know. You need to figure it out. I don't think I've written it in the note, but okay. You find the gauge transformation of a mu in order for d mu to transform linearly, so a mu d mu phi, right? Which is non-trivial, of course, because, you know, here u is actually a space-time a function that depends on space-time, so the derivative can act on d mu, and you need to compensate the variation of, you know, space-time variation of mu by a transformation of a mu, right? That's okay. You probably all know that. It's just gauge theory, right? So here the important thing is that you have a non-linear transformation, a non-linear piece in the transformation of a mu, and this is not consistent with the mass term for the gauge boson. So with this transformation law, you can check for yourself that the mass term for the gauge boson is not invariant. So this means that you cannot write such a mass term in the Lagrangian, and you need somehow to generate the mass, right? So that was one of the big problems. I mean, you know, first time that people were talking about non-abelian gauge group, you know, is Young and Mills, whatever, in 54, I think. And Pauli immediately say, well, this cannot describe nature because, you know, gauge symmetry require that the gauge boson are massless, and we know that those gauge boson cannot be massless, right, to describe electric interaction. So he was really opposed to the non-abelian gauge symmetry because of this mass problem, right? So you need to understand how you can generate the mass to the gauge boson, and the solution came with X mechanism, brought Angular X mechanism, and there is a few extra names associated to this mechanism, Anderson and few other Americans. I've probably forgotten the full list, so I'm not going to write them. And the solution is, again, to assume that simply the gauge symmetry is an exact symmetry of the Lagrangian, but the vacuum is not invariant under this gauge transformation. So the simplest way to realize this breaking by the vacuum is simply to introduce a scalar field. Here, in this case, is the X doublet. So X doublet is transforming under like a doublet of SU2. So it's H plus H0. So it has an hypercharge which is equal to plus 1/2 in this case, right? In such a way that the electric charge is minus 1/2 plus 1/2 for the zero for the lower component, is plus 1 in the upper component. So since this component doesn't have an electric charge, you can actually give a vacuum expectation value to this component without breaking the U1 of electromagnetism gauge invariance, right? So you can have a vacuum expectation value for the X doublet, which is zero, and V, and there for normalization condition, you put a square root of 2, right? And this, will break SU2 symmetry simply because this vacuum expectation value is not invariant under SU2 transformation. SU2 will transform the up and down component. So if you are able to give only expectation value to the lower component, this is clearly a breaking of SU2 symmetry. And at the same time, it respects the U1 electromagnetism invariance, right? Because the electric charge is equal to zero. So this vacuum expectation value really breaks SU2 cross U1 down to U1 of electromagnetism, right? So how can you be sure that the X will acquire expectation value? Simply introduce by hand this particular potential in such a way that at the origin, actually, so this is zero, so this is H0. At the origin, you have a local maximum, and the true minimum is away from the origin, so V divided by square root of 2. And you can do that in introducing a potential which is fully invariant on SU2 cross U1, and it's perfectly renormalizable, so it's H squared minus V squared over 2 squared, right? So this is a potential which is SU2 cross U1 invariant, and it has this shape, right? And again, you have a local maximum at the origin, simply because when you're expanding this potential, in power, you will have minus lambda V squared H squared, right? So this means that the mass term has actually the wrong sign. You have a negative mass squared, so it means that you have really a tachyonic field, right? Plus, et cetera, et cetera, plus. Okay, so there is an instability of the origin, and the true minimum of the potential is away from the origin, and this true minimum breaks the symmetry. And I think I can stop here. It's about 1 hour and 30 minutes. And okay, we will see tomorrow that this generates exactly the mass for the W and the Z, and you can also generate the mass for the fermion, so explain why the mass of the electron is so different than the mass of the neutrino, again, even if the theory is chiral, right? Okay, thanks. So maybe if you have some question, we can discuss during the coffee break or anything. Thanks a lot.